reading for this morning comes from Exodus chapter 14, verses 19 through 31. The angel of the Lord, who was going before the Israelite army, moved and went behind them, and the pillar of cloud moved from in front of them and took its place behind them. It came between the army of Egypt and the army of Israel. And so the cloud was with them in the darkness and lit up the night. One did not come near the other all night. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea. The Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night and turned the sea into dry land, and the waters were divided. The Israelites went into the sea on dry ground, the waters forming a wall on their right and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went into the sea after them, and all of Pharaoh's horses, chariots, and chariot drivers. At the morning watch, the Lord and the pillar of fire and cloud looked down upon the Egyptian army and threw the Egyptian army into panic. He clogged the chariot wheels so that they turned with great difficulty. The Egyptians said, "Let us flee from the Israelites, for the Lord is fighting for them against Egypt." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea, so that the water may come back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots and chariot drivers." So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and at dawn the sea returned to its normal depth, and the Egyptians fled before it. The Lord tossed the Egyptian army into the sea. The waters returned and covered the chariots and the chariot drivers. The entire army of Pharaoh had followed them into the sea. Not one of them remained. But the Israelites walked on dry ground through the sea, the waters forming a wall for them on their right and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel that day from the Egyptians, and Israel saw the Egyptians dead on the seashore. Israel saw the great work the Lord did against the Egyptians. So the people feared the Lord and believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Amen. You pray with me. Mighty God, I pray the words of my mouth, the thoughts on all of our hearts might be acceptable to you. Well, God, you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. We are now about 2 months into this Old Testament sermon series, but we're only on week 3 of telling the story of Moses and the Hebrew people. Now, chances are, over the course of these past 3 weeks, you have at least some familiarity with these stories. Some of them you may know a little bit better than others. But I think out of the 3 weeks, today's story might be the most familiar. We continue to hear the story of Moses and the people who have packed up everything that they own, their entire lives, and followed Moses out of Egypt, finally. Now, they couldn't go across land toward Canaan. That would involve going through 6 Egyptian military outposts. And let's face it, even with all of Moses' attempts to intimidate the Pharaoh, this little band of Hebrew slaves was no match for the strength of the Egyptian army. So the Hebrews found themselves hauling whatever they could from their Egyptian lives right towards the Red Sea. No one knows the route they took exactly. Some think they went right towards the Red Sea. Others think they may have gone further north through some of the tributaries that are found up there, which can be filled with reeds, which is where you sometimes get the confusion of names, Reed Sea, Red Sea. Whatever, either way, we do know that they didn't go over land. Instead, they went towards this huge body of water. Going the land route may have seemed impossible, but I'm not sure the sea route was any better. But we all know the story. On they marched, bravely following Moses, with the Egyptian army in hot pursuit, the waves pounding the shore ahead of them. We all know that story, the story of how Moses stretched out his hand over the sea and the waters parted. The entire Egyptian army was thwarted once and for all. It's the story we know because that's the story that Hollywood has taught us. But our task today is to tell the biblical story, the story recorded in the book of Exodus. And I have to be honest with you, in reading through this story, I don't know if there's a better word to describe it than terrifying. Absolutely terrifying. If we go back a little bit from where we started for today, chapter 13 and 14, we hear a bit what happened since last week. If you recall, the final plague that descended on Egypt resulted in the deaths of the firstborn of every living thing in Egypt. And all the Hebrews that followed God's command and painted their doorposts with the blood of the lamb were spared the final plague. And that was enough to convince Pharaoh to let the Hebrew people go. He basically told them to get out of his hair and to never come back. He had had enough. But just as the dust of the Hebrews' carts was disappearing into the distance, he realized and probably asked himself, what am I doing? Why am I letting them go? I mean, that is the backbone of our economy. What are we going to do without all their labor? So as the future of the economy literally walked away, Pharaoh was concerned, to say the least. Once he realized he had probably made a really big mistake, he gathered the full force of his army, horses, chariots, soldiers, and set out in hot pursuit of the Hebrews. And that's where the people found themselves. Their lives piled on the back of their donkeys, the king's kids asking, are we there yet? Plodding along towards, well, they didn't really know where they were going. And the text explains the terror, the water of the sea in front of them, the critically approaching army behind them, closing in fast. And it was then that the people began to complain. Something they did quite often on this trip, but this is where it starts. They complained to Moses by saying, why in the world do you have to bring us all the way out here to die? I mean, what, the graves in Egypt weren't good enough for you? We told you to leave us alone, but no, you had to go and agitate the Pharaoh, and here we are about to be slaughtered by the army. I believe that I mentioned before that in college, I didn't major in religion or philosophy. I majored in criminal justice. And I began to think this week about something that's called institutionalization. This is something that happens quite often to inmates that are in prison for fairly extended periods of time. They get so used to life in prison that once they are released, they don't know how to live in the free world. So they will commit some crime with the sole intent and purpose of getting sent back to prison. That's the only life they know. That's the only life they think that they can handle. Now, in one of my classes, we watched a movie called The Shawshank Redemption. Some of you may have seen that. It's about a group of inmates at the Shawshank prison who learn that fear is what is really keeping them in prison. Now, early on in the movie, you meet a character named Brooks, who is a longtime inmate. Once he serves his time, he leaves the prison and begins life on the outside. And in one scene in the movie, he is reading a letter that he wrote to his friends who are still in prison, telling them how life is for him on the outside. Now, it's been probably 14 years since I've seen that movie, so I couldn't remember the letter word for word, but thanks to the wonders of the internet and a site called YouTube, I was able to find that scene and get it word for word. And here's what Brooks wrote to his friends who were still in prison. Dear fellas, I can't believe how fast things move on the outside. I saw an automobile once when I was a kid. Now they're everywhere. The world went and got itself in a big bleep hurry. The parole board got me into a halfway house called The Brewer and a job begging groceries at the Foodway. It's hard work, and I try to keep up, but my hands hurt most of the time. Don't think the manager likes me much. Sometimes after work, I go to the park and feed the birds. He then talks about some friends that he once had, and then he picks up again, saying, I have trouble sleeping at night. I have bad dreams like I'm falling. I wake up scared. Sometimes it takes me a while to remember where I am. Maybe I should go and get me a gun and rob the Foodway so they'd send me back home. I could shoot the manager while I was at it, sort of like a bonus. But I guess I'm too old for that sort of nonsense anymore. I don't like it here. I'm tired of being afraid all the time, so I've decided not to stay. I doubt they'll kick up any fuss, not for an old crook like me. And that scene ends with Brooks committing suicide. The fear of his freedom was just too much for him. So strangely enough, this thing that he had longed for years, which was deed out of prison, the reality of that was so fear-infused that he just could not take it. And on the outside, he learned a lesson that the guys on the inside were learning at the same time, which is no matter what our circumstances are, fear is what really keeps us in chains. And that seems to be true for the Hebrews as well. There they were, out in the middle of the desert, right between Pharaoh and his army and this big blue sea. The thing that was keeping them from moving forward was fear. It was so big, it was intimidating, and after years and years of hard, cruel work, misery, violence, and oppression, they were actually suggesting returning to Egypt, because the fear ahead of them was just so overwhelming. It was so much easier to return to what was familiar, even if what was familiar was slavery. Now, I do have to hand it to him. Moses, he was a good leader, a good leader. He was leading the people out in the desert, and he didn't know what would lay ahead of him either. All he knew was that God had led them this far. And as a leader, he didn't have much choice except to stand his ground. And it wasn't that he was unfamiliar with the fear that the people were feeling. He was well acquainted with fear. A couple weeks ago, he talked about all those excuses he had made of why he wasn't able to lead the people. He didn't know how they were going to get out of the situation they found themselves in. All he did know is that they could not return to Egypt. So imagine trying to keep his knees steady and his voice from shaking. Moses told the complaining crowd in verse 13, "Don't be afraid. Stand firm and trust in God. The Lord will fight for you. Just be still and trust." And that's where the text starts to get interesting. We're getting close to our scripture for today. Just a couple verses before, in chapter 14, verse 15, God responds to the fear of the people. Remember, Moses is trying to keep the people calm by telling them to just be still and to wait for God to show up, which isn't an unreasonable request. I mean, God had been showing up in miraculous ways on behalf of the Hebrew people for quite some time now. But look at what God said to Moses. God said, "What are you crying out to me for? Tell the Hebrew people to get moving." God almost seemed impatient and frustrated. And it seems like God is saying, "Look, I brought you out of Egypt. Haven't I proven myself over and over again in the process? Now I'm asking you to join in, to participate in your own redemption, to step out in faith, because it's all right there. It's right in front of you. So get going." It's not quite what we saw in the movie Prince of Egypt, is it? The Hebrew people were out in the middle of the desert with impossibility on one side and complete horror on the other, closing in fast, and God asked them to act in faith, to face their fear, and to move forward. And if we believe Hollywood, as the water parted, there was this wonderful upswelling of music in the background, which we know probably wasn't true. The real soundtrack of the moment was more like the noise of a huge approaching army. Soldiers yelling, chariots creaking, horse hooves pounding, and in the middle of the Hebrew crowd, children crying in terror, people yelling in confusion, nobody exactly sure which way to turn. In a word, terrifying. But God remained firm. "Why are you asking me what to do next? I've laid it out for you as plainly as I can. What it takes now is you facing to your fear, putting one foot in front of the other, and walking towards freedom." And I do have to admit, that had to be hard. That had to be terrifying. They were being asked to step into the unknown, to risk everything dear to them, to follow God not just with their words, but with their very lives. And they were scared. And it was Moses who took God seriously and stepped out in faith, literally in faith. He raised his hand and the waters of the sea began gently lapping outward. And before their fear-filled eyes, a path opened up through the very middle of the sea with ground dry enough to walk on. All they had to do was take the first step. And the question changed. The question was no longer, "Will God bail us out?" The question became, "Will we have the courage to step out in faith?" And they did. To the credit of the Hebrew people, they swallowed their fear, they lifted their feet, and they walked right through the middle of the sea. I mean, I know that the path was there, but the text says the waters made a huge wall on their right and on their left. Every single step had to have taken courage and faith like they had never had before. One step at a time, one foot in front of the other, each step a signal that faith and hope were bigger than the fear that held them back. One step at a time, one foot in front of the other, biting their lips to contain their cries of terror, they walked right through the middle of the sea. Now, the people in Hollywood are not the only ones who see the power of this story and fill in the pages surrounding the text. Rabbis have been doing that for centuries. It's a process called midrash. Think of it like a tradition surrounding the story. And there's a midrash tale about this particular story that suggests that the waters did not, in fact, part with one sweep of Moses' hand, but the waters didn't begin to blow outward until the people started to wade in. Water in front of them, army behind them, God's invitation to move into their future, and when they tied up their robes and took off their sandals and waded hip deep into the water of their fears, it was then that the wind waves picked up and the waters receded and the path emerged. Now, there is nothing to suggest that this kind of faithful living is easy. We tell this story of the Hebrew people, in fact, to illustrate with more drama than we'd ever want to experience in our own lives, that a life of faithfully following God can be terrifying. But brothers and sisters, in the hardest moments of your life and mine, there are decisions that we have to make. This isn't about whether or not we'll lift our feet and take the next step, even though we have no idea what lies ahead, or we're scared beyond belief, or maybe even both. The letter to the Hebrews says that's the essence of faith. It's the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things unseen. We trust in God to guide us, and God expects us to believe, to take the next step into the fear, and move into the promise of everything that our lives can be. Is that terrifying? Sure. But if we get to our verses for today, 19 and 20, the angel of the Lord, who had been out in front leading the people, moved to the back of the crowd. The angel of the Lord came between the Hebrew people and the army of Egypt and made a buffer for them. A pillar of cloud went out ahead of them, leading them forward. And the text describes this as the all-encompassing presence of God in front, behind, on the sides, surrounding the people with protection and guidance, once they had the courage to take the first step. And so it is with us, brothers and sisters. God makes a way. God asks us to act in faith. And God is with us every single step of the way. The Hebrew people felt it more tangibly than they ever had before. Can you imagine the stories they told their grandchildren and children? We feel that same thing too when we step out in faith. Facing our fear, we'll be able to recount the wonderful presence of God as well. God is with us behind and before, protecting and leading right through the middle of the scariest places in our lives. And at the end of our text for today, the people couldn't believe it. They really couldn't believe it. They looked out over this huge expanse of water, Pharaoh's massive army destroyed, and everything they loved safe and dry on the other side of slavery. And they could barely believe it. It was Miriam and the women who voiced the songs of praise for the people, digging in her bag to find her tambourine and shaking the bells in celebration. They danced and sang and exclaimed in awe, "I will sing unto the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously." And it was true. God was faithful. But it took their fear-filled steps into the middle of the sea, their participation in the miraculous deliverance of God, for God's promise and possibility to unfold in their lives. Our story for today invites us to roll up our own pant legs and to take the first step into the water of whatever it is that we fear the most, knowing that God is before us, that God is behind us. God will make a way. We have to take the first steps to wade into the water and believe the promise that God is with us. And that is a promise we can be sure of. And for it, I say thanks be to God. Amen.